Thank you. I trust that we all had a good night's sleep, a good rest. A reasonable at least. And that notwithstanding the problems we had this morning, we've always been seeing it, we're getting excellent services from the hotel. There were some problems with the water provision this morning, but I still trust that everyone was able to do the proper thing so as to assure that we're not getting our neighbors into trouble. That being said, we, just to be on the safe side, an extra welcome to all the new faces in the room today. We have a very interesting program today for our 9th CARICOM Regional Statistical Research Seminar, as you can tell, initiated by the Advisory Group on Statistics. We'll try to stick to our program because you know that our excellent hosts have another treat for us later today. I'm sure nobody wants to miss out on the tour. I'm gonna keep some of you extra in check. I'm gonna have to do that to make sure that we finish in time. Without much further ado, we're going on to the first topic on the program, that is the launch of the Youth Development Index. The presenter is Mr. Lane Robinson of the Commonwealth Secretariat. Lane Robinson is Head of Programs, Youth Division at COMSEC. He studied economics at UW Salesianes. You have the floor.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you so much for the opportunity to share in this seminar on the Youth Development Index on behalf of our Youth Division at the Commonwealth Secretariat. The Commonwealth has invested in this index as a way to help build the data gaps, particularly on young people across the world. Without any further, I would like to go straight into the presentation, which there are the official reports and the toolkit available. I don't know if we have for everyone, but they are available and will be distributed right after. Alternatively, there's a website that you can download the reports and the resources from. The main objectives of the Youth Development Index includes it becoming an evidence-based framework for policy, particularly around youth development. We believe that using such an index, we can monitor and track the progress on youth development over time across regions and countries. And we believe that it will assist us be able to compare data across the economic, political, and cultural spheres, particularly dealing with young people. But at the core of this process, for us in the Commonwealth, it has been a data advocacy strategy whereby there has been a real lack of data on youth development for quite some time. And this work that we have done on the index serves as a massive advocacy piece, or advocacy strategy, in raising the issues pertaining to the lack of data on youth development globally. So let me hasten to define what the Youth Development Index is and what youth development in particular is. Youth in the Commonwealth is defined as young persons in between the ages of 15 and 29 years. And we have come to adopt this definition of youth development as we work through the report, of youth development being a process where we are enhancing the status of young people, empowering them to build their competencies and capabilities for life. Youth development enables young people to contribute and to benefit from the politically stable, economically viable, and legally supportive environment, ensuring their full potential as active citizens in their countries. So the focus on enhancing young people's status, on their empowerment, building their capabilities and competencies are what we define as comprising youth development in this report. Why a youth development index? Many persons would have asked. In 2013, when the first report was done, Many persons were asking why the Youth Development Index was done. In 2013, it was the first comprehensive attempt to assess youth development across countries. And what why this was important was that we realized that 87% of the young people are living in a developing context, and we didn't have enough information about what was happening to them, and yet policies were being designed and developed. We also took note of the fact that in the Commonwealth, 60% of the 2 billion citizens are young people under the age of 30. And again, because of the size of the population, much more information is needed on them. And then finally, youth development is not a one-dimensional subject. Youth development actually has many facets, and therefore, to study it and understand it better, we needed to be able to get the data on a range of topics and issues, range of areas of focus, so that we could better understand what's happening with the youth population. I mean, many persons tend to want to offer one-off solutions for young people, but what we have found is that youth development is multifaceted, and we need to then be able to study youth development across different areas. And of course, I mentioned the importance of data advocacy. This was at the core of what we were doing, because there's the lack of data globally on young people. So what is the index? The Youth Development Index is a composite index, first and foremost, that is comprised in the 2016 version of 18 key indicators over 5 domains, which collectively measure what we are calling youth development. It covers 183 countries, including 49 of the 52 Commonwealth member states. For many who will be familiar with the Human Development Index, the Youth Development Index is similar in that it scores development between 0 and 1, so that the closer a country comes to the 1, they are doing much better in their youth development. It combines quantitative data from a number of administrative and public sources, and a few public surveys to produce the index. And in this version, it compiles data from 2010 to 2015. This really is the best attempt at harmonizing this data and this set of data, and therefore, I mean, we're commending this report to you as statisticians and to policymakers and stakeholders in the sector. The weightings were done by an expert group. As you know, it's an index, and so you will notice in the report weightings have been done, and this was done by working through with experts in youth development. And when you go to the website, you will notice that in the report, you will see that the report can be viewed from different angles, regionally, based on the youth bulge. You can begin to look at, you know, how the data affects young people using different categories. Why a composite index? And this is one of the questions that we grappled with at the beginning of the process in leading into 2013. But a composite index really summarizes really complex multidimensional issues. It facilitates comparisons for a big picture. So when we talk about the results later, you will see that I can share some summary, some big, broad points with you, and you will kind of have a sense of what is happening in the youth sector. It allows us to monitor and evaluate and even to promote some level of accountability for stakeholders in the sector. And it really does attract public interest. One of the things that we noticed after producing the reports, both in 2013 and this year as well, is that immediately lots of countries and persons are interested in where is my country on the index. And this then creates a space for further dialogue on what youth development needs to be and ought to be at a country level. But using a composite index is not without problems. One of the main challenges is that it tends to be simplistic, and persons tend to get bogged down in where I am on the ranking, as opposed to the more meaningful discussion on youth development. I'll speak briefly now about the indicator and a little bit about the data selection. As I mentioned earlier, the sources really has been administrative data sources, and largely from World Bank, UN sources across the board, ILO, you'll see them in the report. We've also had to use survey data, Gallup data in particular, to help bolster where there was real lack of data. In order to make the index relevant, we also had to make sure it was meeting the body of literature. It was speaking to what we know in the sector. I mean, we're looking for whether what we have been espousing over these many years in youth development is delivered through the index, and we are finding that. We initially started with over 50 indicators, because this is what is presented in the global frameworks on youth, whether in the Commonwealth or in the World Program of Action on Youth, but we eventually came down to 18 key indicators that we think were relevant. And so the 5 domains you will see have remained education, health and well-being, employment and opportunities, civic participation, and political participation. And in the report, you will see a discussion on these five domains and what is happening for youth development across the sectors. These are the 18 indicators in the domains, as I mentioned earlier. You will notice, and those who are familiar with the 2013 report, that some new indicators have been added in, including for education, digital natives, because more young people are now using internet and computers. We have to track that one. You will also notice in the health and well-being and inclusion of mental disorder as a key component. Again, this is quite new. And the most important one for us has been the inclusion of NEET data, which in the 2013 version was not there. And NEET, of course, you know, is the measuring young people not in education, employment, or training, and to see what is happening to them. Youth unemployment was not really giving a full picture of what, youth unemployment was not giving a full picture of what was happening for young people who are sometimes not in even training as well. So these are the indicators, and I guess a more robust discussion of them we can have at the end of the process. So the development index helps us to gain a better understanding of what's happening in the sector and to help allow us to fill the data gaps where they are over time. This has been the challenge that we will try and work through. There have been challenges in working on this index, and I've highlighted a few of them here in this discussion. One is the harmonization of the age groups for youth. As I mentioned earlier this week, different organizations and countries use different age groups. 15 to 24 in the Commonwealth is 15 to 29. And so harmonizing this data has been a challenge, and we have tried to do that. Small states tend to be problematic. Some would argue that because countries are small, they should do better with data. But the lack of capacity has been a challenge here, which is why presenting at this meeting might be an important discussion. Thematically, the area of civic and political participation remains a challenge, primarily because, you know, youth want to be involved in their countries at the civil society level, at the governmental level, and getting the accurate data to measure this participation is really a weak area within the index. Disaggregated data, we want the index to be disaggregated for gender and all the various, whether it's ethnic groups and so on, but that data is just not available, and so we continue to struggle with getting disaggregated data. And of course, national averages tend to hide what's happening in countries. And you will see this coming out particularly for large countries like India. How do you give an index for the whole of India? They have so many people in that country. What's happening at the different sub-national levels is something that the index does not speak to, but it remains a problem for us. What the index is not, it's not a lot of things. It's not. It doesn't cover all aspects of youth. Youth development takes time to change. It's not going to be able to pick up those changes so quickly. So if a country just introduced a youth policy today, you might not see the results of that policy until a few years. Composite index tend to measure complex ideas, and so the fluctuations and inequalities sometimes are hidden in overall scores. So the index is not the solution to the youth sector. It contributes to helping the sector to become much more robust in how it interprets data that it's getting. The index can be seen at the website youthdevelopmentindex.org, and there you'll be able to download not just the reports, but I've brought some copies of the toolkit that will help countries to do their website. Their own work, on the website, as well as other important information from young people from other countries and so on that may be helpful. Some of the highlights very quickly. The majority of the world, 144 countries showed improvements in the index this time around. The movements have been gradual from 2010 to 2015, but most countries showed improvements. And I think that may be expected. There's been a lot of focus on youth development now across many countries, not the least of which because of the Arab Spring, and so many persons are now talking about youth development. Many international development partners are putting in new programs on youth. We're seeing a lot of changes in the youth sector. And that may be probably why we're seeing some improvements. There may be other factors as well. As a result of this, 1.2 billion young people living in countries now are showing progress in their youth development. The top 10 worst performing countries all have youth bulges of between 24 to 29%. So the countries that are really struggling the most have huge youth populations. And I hasten to say that all of these are in sub-Saharan Africa. The huge youth bulge is both an opportunity, but if it's not harnessed, it could also have implications for national development. What do you do with a country, for example, like Nigeria, that has 70% of its population being young people? If they are not included, if the policies are not responding to them, you're going to have challenges in that sector and therefore a knock-on challenge on the rest of the population. I want to just hasten on to probably share with you probably some of the other findings so that we have time for discussion. The top 10 countries, I don't know if it's very clear, but let me read them out for you. Germany, number one, Denmark, Australia, Switzerland, United Kingdom, Netherlands, Australia, Luxembourg, Portugal, and Japan. Nearly all of these are, eight of them are European countries, and they are really all developed countries. So you can see a trend there. And the bottom 10 countries were all in Africa: Mali, DRC, Zambia, Mozambique, Guinea-Bissau, Equatorial Guinea, Niger, Cote d'Ivoire, Chad, and Central Republic, Central Africa Republic. So all these countries are in the Africa region. Again, you can see the discrepancies and the challenges there. One of the things to note in this study is that over time, we'll be seeing now a falling off of the youth populations going forward into the rest of this century, that this is the point in time when we have the highest proportion of young people at our country levels. But after this, we're expecting to see a decline in the youth populations. That means that there is an opportunity now to invest in young people because it will result in reaping the dividend for that in the future. I think this slide will not be clear, but I hope you'll be able to see it in the report. And what this shows is the regional comparisons across the 9 regions. And I'll just flag up the Caribbean region for you so you can see Central Africa and Caribbean has nearly 56 million young people, 3% of the world's population. Youth make up a quarter of the total population in the region, in this region. The region ranked fifth overall of the 9 regions. 85% of the country showed improvements in the YDI score. The region had the third highest, greatest improvement in their YDI score, and civic and political participation rose the greatest in this region. Haiti and St. Vincent and the Grenadines showed decline in the score over the 5 years. Trinidad and Tobago and Salvador showed the greatest improvements. Trinidad and Tobago actually showed an improvement of about 10%. And there has been remarkable improvement for all countries on adolescent fertility rate, actually over 5%. So it's still very high, but it's improving. And political participation is a strength in the region, actually coming just behind South America globally in terms of the other regions. And civic and political participation saw large improvements, primarily due to the fact that young people are volunteering more and are voicing their opinions to officials. In terms of the regional ranking, Barbados is coming out top with ranked 28th overall globally, followed by Jamaica at 46. You can see there Antigua, 72, and so on. Not all the countries in this region have been in the index. There was a rule that we had to take where if a country didn't have at least 50% of the data, we wouldn't put them in the index, so we can ensure that we are given good representation of what's happening in the countries. You will see comparisons if you get a chance to go on the website. On gender, lots of changes. I'll just mention this, Mr. Chairman, just to probably make the point that the gender gap is there in the index. For NEET data, we note that 66% of young people not in education, employment, or training are female. Also took note that young women and young girls are unemployment is 10 times higher than others, and you'll see a gender comparison throughout the rest of the report. Let me just go now to just a brief point on where we could go with this. So we have produced a toolkit that we'd want our NSOs to look at and to examine as a way to help our ministries of youth embed this kind of framework, research framework, in their duties. We have done pilots in Australia and in Barbados. Barbados is still working on their YDI. No country in the region has yet produced a YDI, and I would want to encourage from this audience that some of the countries pick this up and try to do that as well. Going forward, a few recommendations. NSOs could work with youth ministries and youth to improve youth data and statistics as far as is possible, and I think the presentation this week spoke to that. We're encouraging countries to spend, I think good data is already there. The region is doing really well, but we are encouraging more, and the YDI provides a framework for that to happen. Development partners, counting on them to support this focus on data collection at a national level. Looking at supporting national YDI projects and improving the youth policy framework overall. And of course, we want to, as a Commonwealth, we want to continue to work with others to deepen the research on what some of these data, what the data is telling us, so that we can actually make good policy recommendations for the future. Next steps, we certainly want to promote the national YDI. We want to encourage partnerships where they exist, and we want to advocate for better data and want to ensure that all countries actually go ahead and do national work on their youth development framework so that their policies can be much better. I want to thank you very much for listening, and I hope that we can have some good discussion on what this means. It's not a perfect index, it's a work in progress, but I commend this report to you and ask that you study it and take it back to your countries and integrate it in the work you're already doing, I think, on national statistics frameworks across the region and in your countries. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think you all agree with me that we've had a splendid kickoff. Lynn Robinson set the bar high for those to follow. The floor is now open for interventions, questions.
Thanks a lot, Chair. Let me first commend Lynn and ComSec for the ambition behind this piece of work. It's quite involved and potentially could serve a very useful purpose. The whole issue of index and indices construction is always one that could be very challenging, no? We at the bank use something called country policy and institutional assessments when we want to allocate scarce resources. And it could become quite contentious in the sense that we may have a position on what the data is telling us, first of all. Secondly, there could be a pushback on the type of data that is used. One of your domains speak to political participation. And you've got here as an indicator, I think, voice opinion to officials. I'm just wondering how that is captured, because I guess there are several avenues through which the youth and the voices of the youth may be communicated to the political directorate through official and unofficial channels. So I'm just wondering how this is captured. And if this is something that, again, could be quite contentious, if what you are seeing as an official channel may be seen as unofficial by others. And because you don't have an official channel, does it mean, therefore, that you're not communicating with the political directorate? But again, I want to commend you on the piece of work. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you for that question, CDB. Ishua, I should not say CDB today, okay.
Thank you, Chair. Mr. Robinson, thank you very much for your presentation. It was very enlightening. I want to make a comment on the indicator on the existence of a youth policy. While that's important, I think what's even more important is the quality of the youth policy and whether it's aligned to national development priorities and sector strategies, particularly sectors that have significant implications for the other dimensions you mentioned, whether it's employment, economic development, and so on. So I don't know how you could perhaps look at that indicator again, if you think it's a good idea, and to see how we can make it more of a quality indicator than just looking at the existence. And I say this because we struggle with this in our sector, the gender sector, where a gender policy might exist, but it's really very useless because it's not aligned to national development priorities. It's just kind of ghettoized, balkanized in a corner if it exists. So that's just one suggestion. And then thanks very much for acknowledging that the gender disparities still exist. And while there's a lot of progress that has been made, and while we have to acknowledge the underperformance of boys and in school and underachievement of males at university level, we'll still see these persistent gender disparities among young people. Thank you very much.
Okay. Abdul?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Let me also join the previous speakers in commending the Commonwealth Secretariat and Mr. Robinson for a path-breaking work. And I'm glad to know that you say this is work in progress, because my comments centered on how to possibly improve this going forward. So I haven't had the opportunity to read the report, so these may, some of the things I'm raising may have been addressed in the report, so forgive me for that. Something that caught my attention was the fact that you're using expert opinion, right, which could be very subjective, irrespective of the fact that these are experts, and that you are using the index to rank countries, right? So my first question is, do you do these, the index, the values, would they be generated annually? And if so, will the weighting that the expert come up with, how do you revise that? Is it a one-off thing? Do you do it annually or do you do it every decade? Because the issue is if you're using the index and individual countries are using this to see how they are progressing, that's fine. When you use that to rank countries and you are looking at economic, cultural, and political spheres, then it becomes a little subjective. A country might think, you know, the cultural issue has a higher weight, whereas other countries, for example, the developing countries might think that the cultural domain should be very important and should have a higher weight, whereas somebody from a developed country might think, you know, political participation of youth should be more highly weighted. So these are some of the issues that I don't know how you have addressed them or how you plan to address them to make this more acceptable. Thank you.
Are there any more questions on this presentations? If not, we will give Lane a chance. Yeah, okay, one more.
Good morning, and thank you very much, Lane, for coming and give this presentation. Just a quick question on the depth of involvement in the past of the statistical offices. I know that we have had the meeting with you and the AGS, but what was the depth of involvement in the past of the statistical offices, including in the pilot you mentioned in Barbados? And also a question on the rationale. It seems that you group in Central America and the Caribbean. So what is your rationale for that? Thank you.
Okay, please go ahead.
Thank you very much. Probably start with the last question, because I think it's an important one. One of the flaws in the work so far has been that, you know, the youth sector has tried to do it all. And I don't think that was an appropriate strategy. So having produced a 2013 index, one of the things that we have tried to do is to now begin to have a conversation between the youth sector and to bring the relevant sector, the NSOs, on board, which is why we're at this meeting, first of all, but also been trying to work through the AGS to make sure that collaboration is happening. The youth sector is very vibrant. The youth officials tend to be very vibrant. Young people themselves tend to be very vibrant. But to get what they want done at country level, they need the support of stakeholders. And I think one of the critical stakeholders has to be, going forward, NSOs and persons working with data. And I think it hasn't been strong enough in the past, which is why probably they struggled a bit. So we have been working in the Commonwealth with countries in the Pacific and now in the Caribbean as well to bring the close this gap. In the Pacific, we've brought them into the training sessions with the youth officials, and you can see the dialogue that happened. The same here when we had the stakeholder meeting in June this year with the youth sector and the officials. So I think that work is underway, and whereas it was not done adequately in the past, going forward we should work more closely together. And I would call on NSOs here, when you go back to country, to engage with the youth sector, see what they are doing. They are probably producing results, they are producing reports like this, but not with the knowledge of the NSO. So this is a strategy that could help. But importantly, linking Latin America and the Caribbean, well, what we try to do in the report, as one of the young reports coming through, they're already well-established global reports, We try to follow the pattern of those reports. Not probably the best thing, but at this stage, we are a new report, and you know, to take on some of the big issues, I don't think we're able to. So we've kept the 9 categories as other reports have done from the UN and so on. But what we have allowed is for the data could be broken down at regional level. And hence why a meeting like this one, you could agree to take the index, all the data sets, and to produce a regional index working with us. That's something that we could do together as an outcome from this process, because the data is all there. What we were able to do is to just keep the mean on all the regions, the South Pacific, Asia Pacific region. We've kept the regions to be consistent with other global reports. That was the rationale behind it. But we really want to see regional and national level work happen so that you can better define your own realities as well, because these indicators may not fit for the Caribbean region. You may want to include new indicators given the data sets that you have as well. Thank you for the question on the weightings and so on. This was one of the issues in this report going for this time around. What we have done to solve the problem is that the weightings, we have kept them to be equal across the domains, so that education has an overall weighting of 25%, health and well-being 25%, employment 25%, political participation 15%, and civic participation 10%. And these two last ones, even though we want them to be equal, the data is not so rich, which is going to lead to the other question. The data is not perfect there. It's probably the weakest part of the whole index. There's not enough robust data, hence we didn't want that to have a knock-on effect on the overall index. So if a country has a policy, what does that mean? Does it mean that the country should be, you know, just because having a policy? No. So it rated less to kind of nullify the impact of those indicators that are not as strong, the data is not as rich, and as not as would like them to be. So we've kept, I mean, this is what the experts said to us. The statisticians wanted to use more scientific methods to determine the indicators, but the experts said, for ease of what you're mentioning, let's keep them equal. On the index, what you can do, it allows us to go in if we wanted to change the weightings as individuals. So in the office, I can go in and I can affix a weighting to different things, you know, just to see how it plays out. But we've kept them equal in the main, so that we're trying to at least keep the domains roughly, the big ones, the powerful ones, roughly consistent, and not to disturb, you know, variations and make it too subjective. But you're right, it is an issue. How do we do the data? The youth data is not going to be so rich so as to allow an annual report coming through. We suspect that every 3 to 5 years we might need to do the report because the data points are just, the data is just not there in the way that we'd like to see it going forward. The time lag between the 2013 and this one was really because now, over the last 2 years, really a lot of good data has come on board. Which really was vast difference from the 2013 one. And we expect that as the SDG process takes hold and countries are improved to participate in the data revolution, much more data will become available and we could see how that happens. But right now it will be every, probably about 3 to 5 years that we will have the report. Going to the question on the existence of the policy, yes, as I mentioned, we also are not happy with just having the existence of a policy or not having a policy. So it's one of the areas that needs improvement in the index. How do you measure participation? How do you measure civic or political participation? Is an area that we need much more research on. In Mexico, they have done some work on political participation and have produced a youth participation index, which we are studying as well. And other countries now are beginning to look at this issue because we have flagged it up as a weak area. We talk about youth participation, but the data to support it is just not there. And so the indicators we have put here are probably the best attempt that we could find at trying to capture what this area means, but we'd love to work with others to invest more in how to measure participation better for countries. Just to mention also, what we have been doing is doing further research. So we're partnering with UNESCO in this area to go beyond asking whether they just have a youth policy, to we're asking, do you have a policy and how does it link to the national development? So we are currently doing a survey across all the countries of UNESCO, which all the countries of the Commonwealth are a part of that as well, to see if we could capture what's happening beyond just having a policy. Is it linked up? Is it being serviced? Is it funded? And all these relevant questions. So you're perfectly right. That's something that we need to do as a further research. And then finally, in terms of the indicator dealing with the voice opinion, I mean, this data set in particular, this indicator comes to us from surveys done through the Gallup poll. And so what it attempts to measure is voice officials between ages 15 to 24 and trying to see how how accessible young persons are to engaging with their decision makers at the local and other levels. Now, this is, again, this is in the domain of participation, which is not a perfect indicator for this, but this is one that we think helps alongside existence of voter education and having a policy. So overall, you can see this indicator is not a very strong, this domain is not a very strong one overall, but it's the best that we could find at this stage in terms of trying to gauge how young persons are interacting with the decision makers, which is something we are big on in the youth sector, that young people should be a part of the decision-making process. So if they are talking to their leaders, are engaging, that's something that we value in this sector, so we've included it here. There are other non-traditional means that are picking up now. So social media is big. A lot of young people are engaging, participating in social media, which is why we've tried to include digital natives in this index, but under more education. But it is something that is going to be much more studied going forward, and we'd welcome support on this to strengthen the civic and political participation indicators.
Thank you, Lane. We have to close this one off. It was interesting, and we got some good questions. Let us just conclude that it is indeed an important work in progress. We have to accept, and that is particularly to my friend Abdullah, that there is some intersubjectivity. Yes, this type of work, I mean, some people would want to use factor analysis to derive at weights, but you would run into difficulties, I suspect, with domain 4 and domain 5 mm-hmm. with your factor analysis. I think the main point that we could take from this is what was mentioned, that the CCS and ComSec work together to work on a regional index for CARICOM. And I take it really CARICOM means CARICOM members, associate members, and in this case, we would take the observers on board too.
That's right.
Can I ask for one more round of applause for Lane, please? Okay, you see, I got my chair already. It's a good thing to be the chair. Thanks. May I now call to the head table Amir Heck of the Central Bureau of Statistics. Topic 2 is determinants of poverty and gender inequality in Curacao. I'm sure we'll hear a lot of good things, and especially be careful about what you say regarding gender inequality. Let me see. Okay. Amir Heck has studied econometrics and operations research at the Free University in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. Additionally, he received his master's in financial management with valedictorian honor at Erasmus University in conjunction with the University of Curacao. His research interests span a wide range of topics in econometric methods with applications in business and economics. He is currently actively involved in research projects at the Central Bureau of Statistics, acting in a consultancy capacity through Precision Insights, a local management and research consultancy firm. In addition, he serves as secretary and treasurer for a Curacao-based foundation. I just have to put my proper papiamento. Fundación Nos Causa, that aims to empower the local community through social and cultural development. Amir Heck.
Okay, the topics of this presentation are determinants of poverty and gender inequality in Curaçao. Okay, the presentation is structured as follows. Firstly, I shall cover the rationale for research, conceptual framework, measurements of poverty, and then I cover our literature review, descriptive statistics, our research methodology, and finally, I discuss our findings and conclude in the last section. Okay. In pursuit of reducing poverty, the concept of targeting gender bias against women remains contentious and lacks rigorous evidence, which makes this study instructive and important from both an academic and a practical perspective. And the precise nature of this nexus between gender and poverty needs to be better understood and operationalized in policy making. Eradicating poverty and eliminating gender bias are intrinsic sustainable development goals spearheaded by the UN, which are central to economic development. These two issues are important and especially challenging in a socially and economically diverse country like Curaçao. In February 2016, the government of Curaçao has approved a national development plan that was prepared with the assistance of the UNDP. This national development plan is based on a long-term vision of change for Curaçao in five interlocked themes, namely education, economy, sustainability, national identity, and good governance. As a part of the process, a focus on four of the 17 SDGs was agreed upon, from which I shall highlight two, which are to ensure quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all, and also to promote sustained, inclusive, and sustainable economic growth, both full and productive employment and decent work for all. Okay, now within this context of these SDGs, the main objectives of this study are to estimate and compare the effects of key demographic, household, and socioeconomic determinants of poverty in general, and furthermore find evidence on gender inequality. In other words, linkages of whether gender increases the likelihoods of being poor. This is evaluated by addressing the research question of whether female-headed households are poorer than their male counterparts. Our conceptual framework is defined as follows. We have, with regard to socioeconomic characteristics, we have taken into account the education level, marital status, occupation, and economic status of the head of household. As for demographic characteristics, we've incorporated gender, geographical area of residence, age, immigrant status, and whether the head of household has ever lived abroad into our model. And finally, in the addition of household characteristics, which are household size, most spoken language, parenthood, and dependency ratio. These are all categorical or dichotomous variables. Okay, it's worth noting that arguments over how poverty should be conceptualized, defined, and measured go beyond semantics and academic debates. Poverty can be measured in a variety of ways. The World Bank has defined poverty as the inability to attain a minimum standard of living. Poverty exists when one or more persons fall short of a level of economic welfare deemed to constitute a reasonable minimum, either in some absolute sense or by the standards of a specific society. Then it is necessary to determine how to assess welfare. In this respect, there are mainly three approaches in literature found, which are the welfareist approach, the basic needs approach, and the capabilities approach. And since our poverty line is defined as the income level at which an average household can acquire just enough resources to live a healthy life, our research focuses on the basic needs approach. Thus, a poor household is defined as a household of which the combined income of all its members is less than the poverty line as determined for an average household, which is $1,311 monthly. Here are some descriptive statistics from the darker shade of gray. Yeah, depict the ratio of income-deprived households by gender for a few categorical variables. We chose to highlight the most influential factors, which are education, parenthood, economic status, and geographical area of residence. From these graphical representations, it's evident that the head count of female-headed households is larger than the head count of their male counterparts, which is the case for every variable we've looked at. As for the literature review, in this table, we see the categories we compare against their respective baselines, a description of the various categories, and the hypotheses derived in literature. For example, if we look at our categorical variable gender, we'd expect female-headed households to have a higher likelihood to be poor than their male counterparts. Following with research methodology. The common approach to estimating a binary dependent variable is to use a binary logistic regression was applied using household secondary level data derived from Census 2011 using complete cases. The data set is split in half by taking a random sample of all observations. One data set is used to build the model, and the other is used to examine the accuracy of the constructed model. The specification of the logistic regression can be expressed as follows. A maximum likelihood estimation finds the parameter estimates that maximize the log likelihood function as depicted in this slide. The results of the logistic regression are depicted in terms of odds ratios and average marginal effects, which are obtained by conducting a Krinsky and Robb Monte Carlo simulation and using the bootstrapping method. Let's take a look at our findings. Gender, geographical area, economic status, and parenthood are the most influential factors. Odds ratios are appropriate to analyze associations between baseline groups and prevalent data. And the marginal effects depict discrete changes from the base level, holding all other constants, all other variables constant. For example, we see that the likelihood of a female-headed household to be poor is larger than their male counterpart by a factor of 1.6. As for parenthood, for example, the presence of minorities of children, caregivers, we see that if there are children present within that household has a likelihood to be poor, which is bigger than if there weren't any children present, also by a factor of 1.6. And relative to the reference category of being employed, a head of household which is unemployed has a higher likelihood to be poor by a factor of 6.5. And we see that education and geographical area of residence is also very much of influence. Okay. And following with few significant and significance and diagnostic tests that are performed to assess the validity and predictive ability of our model. The WALT test is used to test individual coefficients, deviance used to assess the model fit, and the likelihood ratio test is used to test global null hypotheses. Okay, as for our diagnostic tests, multicollinearity is checked for by computing variance inflation factors. The Cook's distance and outlier test is evaluated to look at outliers that may deteriorate our model. As for goodness of fit, the Homsch-Lemeschau test is used to check for it. And the discrimination capacity is assessed through our receiver operating curve plot. The model satisfies all diagnostic tests. Okay, a decent McFadden and a nasal Kirky R-square and a high percentage of correct predictions have led to the selection of our model, indicating that the model was able to distinguish between non-poor and poor with an accuracy of around 80%. Okay, these are a few effect plots which show our predicted probabilities, from which we also conclude that female-headed households are marginally poorer than their male counterparts. The analysis presented above enables policymakers to clearly see the effect of various socioeconomic, demographic, and household characteristics on monetary poverty, and has found evidence of gender inequality. Strategies aimed at reducing poverty can be directed at these factors. This study can help improve the design of poverty alleviation programs tailored for specific household structures and determine the ways in which resources can be distributed as to maximize poverty reduction and can be used as a tool to track development goals. Future research can be conducted by focusing on multidimensional poverty and measuring the trends in these determinants of poverty. I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I shall.
Excellent, and within time, I didn't even have to signal him. The floor is open.
Thanks, Chair. Just a very brief one, Amir. I want to thank you for your presentation. It's quite heavy, and for those around the table, not schooled in econometrics, it might have been a bit challenging to follow. That notwithstanding, just one comment, and you sort of hinted it in the next steps, as it were, which is around multidimensional approaches to poverty. Because what we didn't touch on just now was the whole issue of the impact of disasters on poverty. People who or groups of individuals who may be just above the poverty line may be impacted by a natural disaster which pushes them down below the poverty line. And that's certainly a feature within the Caribbean setting. So perhaps if in your next steps, we can look at that. Perhaps it may throw a different light on the findings and conclusions of the report. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. Excellent presentation, and it pretty much confirms what we know in terms of a prior information that when you look at the disconnect between education and the male-female gap, that generally, those who are undereducated typically end up into the poverty end, and the female generally are, you know, lower paid compared to the male counterpart. I just wanted to know, in terms of the choice of model as it relates to the low-gene model, Why did you choose that versus, for example, a probate model, especially when you get to the point of the probability testing? Also, given that this pretty much is confirming what we already know, is there a forecastability nature of the model? For example, you did some Monte Carlo simulation. Is there a forecastability component of that to say, for example, in the next 5 years, what do you anticipate in terms of a shift, whether you expect there to be a gender closing that gap for male, female, for example? Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. And thank you for a very well explained research. My question is actually linking up with Dr. McFarlane's point. We already know what your research is confirming, what we already know, what we are suspecting. So, and you mentioned that this would be good for policy intervention, which is, I totally agree with you. And that's where the predictability or the forecastability will be of importance. For example, we know that women are poorer or those with education. Then you want to now tell the policymakers that if you, you know, increase, if you improve a particular variable by so much, this is what you expect to happen. So I was looking at the probability prediction charts that you have, but I don't quite understand what those things mean. There is a, like, the third to the last slide, if you could bring it back up, please. This, we have male prediction probability for the first section. What is that first box saying?
Are there any more questions? Yes, Ishua. And let me make it clear, you don't have to be seated behind a microphone to ask a question. You could ask a question, those there, you can ask a question. If you need to ask a question, just go to the nearest microphone. Okay, Ishua.
Everyone thought I would ask a question, but I want to really commend you for your presentation. I got also a little bit lost because I'm not a statistician or an econometrist or whatever. But just to reiterate what was said, what are the implications for policy making? And also there's a trend in the Eastern Caribbean anyway of using data like this to do targeting, poverty targeting for households to see whether, you know, a particular household, what is the quantum of support that it will get financially based on the results of poverty measurements, right? So I'm wondering whether in Curacao there's a similar initiative in place, or you know, in other words, how are these results? What are the policy implications for all of this? Because we already know, you are proving already, you are giving us evidence of what we already know to be true, that the burden of care is higher among households, particularly households with children, and so you're going to see higher incidences of poverty in those households. So then the question is, what would then be the what are the tools, what are the implications for policy making to close the gaps that exist? Thank you.
Okay, could you please answer the question?
Yes. Thank you for your comments and questions. Let me start off with our predicted probabilities. As we see here, for example, if the economic status of a male would be that a male-headed household, of the head of household, would be that he is employed. So that would indicate that his, on average, that his likelihood to be poor is, as you see, less than 0.2. As for a woman, you see that it's higher. And if there were to be a discrete change, as in he goes from being employed to being unemployed, that we see that his likelihood to be poor, that was under 0.2, would increase to above 0.6. Whereas for a female-headed household, it's 0.7, again indicating that their chances to be poor are higher. And as for parenthood, for example, if there are no children present within a household where there is a male head of household, his probabilities to be poor would be above 0.2, whereas for a woman, it's close to around 0.32. And looking at these plots, we hold all other variables constant, and we just take these into consideration, and we see actually what the marginal effects of these discrete changes would be. Okay, and as for, I hope that clears up your question. As for my choice of using a logit against a probit, it's both applicable, and you can use them both, but I just chose I had a feeling that it was very technical, so I wanted to remain within 20 minutes also, so that's why I just chose to present a logit side of our model. But a probit is also adequate, and let me see, yeah, we said the marginal effects aren't easily derived. As for a probit or logit models, the estimates aren't easy to interpret. That's why we simulated the marginal effects, and we tried two methods to see if it's the same. One method assumes normality, the other does not. And I was very happy to see that the marginal effects were the same. Both ways, and it does serve forecast. It can be used as a forecasting tool, since it does distinguish poor from the non-poor adequately. Okay, and as for multidimensional poverty, we have done a preliminary study thereof. However, it's research in progress, and because we noticed that somebody mentioned vulnerability to be poor, right? If you're according to the poverty line, if you're poor, that means you fall under the poverty line, but doesn't say anything about the vulnerability of being poor, which is a far larger category. So multidimensional poverty, which looks at various dimensions, which education, livelihood, so household characteristics. We take that into account also, and we see that there are many vulnerable households which are vulnerable poor. Okay, so it's crucial to look at that as well. And as for, there was one more question about actually, this research helps identify the poor, right? And what are these implications for policy? Well, let's, for example, we see that a certain region is much poorer than the other region. We would help target those specific household types, family sizes, and if certain regions or certain household types have a higher likelihood to be poor, we would consider improving our family planning services, having training programs for the unemployed, and improve their employability. And although everybody has access to education, we do have a high dropout rate, so we need to reduce that also by stimulating our youth to finish schools and such. I hope I answered all your questions accordingly, and thank you for your attention.
Okay. Thank you very much. He really followed it. I think you should stay in here. I would agree with Ishua. This study is of interest to linking MPI and money poverty and for targeting. It was an excellent presentation within time. We know you're making the presentation on the third one as well. Okay. The third one is the validity of Okun's law in Curacao. I invite Shekina there. She is an economist at the research department. I'm not going to read out Amir Heck's bio a second time. At the research department of the Central Bank of Curacao and St. Martin, where she analyzes and reports on financial and economic developments, conducts research, provides policy advices, and prepares presentations and speeches for the management of the bank. She obtained her master's degree, graduating with honors in financial economics from the Erasmus University in Rotterdam in 2012. She also obtained her teaching certificate, graduating with highest honors in 2015 because of her passion for teaching, especially youngsters. You look like a youngster myself. Okay, you don't need to know what I just said. She currently teaches bachelor students in business economics and high school students in economics, management and organization, and mathematics, as well as guiding them with their research projects. Her main research interests are in the fields of education, labor market, economic growth, macroeconomic modeling, and forecasting. Amir Heck and Shekina Dare, the validity of Okun's law in Curacao.
Good morning. First of all, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to be here, that we can actually present this paper. This paper resulted from a collaboration between the Central Bank of Curacao and St. Martin, and also the Central Bureau of Statistics of Curacao. So Amir from the Central Bureau of Statistics and myself from the CBCS. The validity of Okun's law in Curacao. Today we're going to discuss with you the following 6 points. First, I will go through the research objective and also the literature review. Then my colleague will continue with the case of Curacao and the data and method. Then I will continue with empirical results, and my colleague will finish with the conclusion. Regarding the research objective, our main question was, does Okun's law actually apply to the Curacao economy? We hear a lot about Okun's law, but what is it actually, and why did we study it for Curacao? Well, in our case, there are 2 reasons. The first one is one that my colleague already discussed in his previous presentation with regards to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals with regards to full employment. Why? Because full employment is an important aspect when we talk about supporting macroeconomic stability and also maximizing output growth. In addition, as we have seen for Curacao's economy, in the last few years, we've seen that the economy has remained stagnant, declining in the 2013 and 2014, and registering meager economic growth in 2015, while unemployment rate has been declining throughout those years, which actually contradicts to Okun's law. Now, you might be asking yourself, what is Okun's law, actually? Because it probably might have been some time ago that you've studied it or that you've heard of it. So, to give you a bit of enlightenment, Okun's law, or better said, Arthur Okun, is an economist that was the first economist to study the relationship between output growth and unemployment. So what changes does output affect have an effect on unemployment? He used the US economy as his database and using quarterly time series data. This is a graph just to give you an indication. His first research was based on gross national product, but other researchers also use gross domestic product, which is also what we will use. With regards to literature review, it is important to know that literature distinguishes 3 types of unemployment: structural, frictional, and cyclical. Cyclical, as you may already kind of notice, cyclical, it is with regards to the business cycles. So a downturn in business cycles affects then the unemployment of people, because when the economy is not going well, people, the employers lay off people, or they reduce the number of hours that people work. Frictional unemployment is with regards to the job seekers that go into and out of jobs. So for example, when someone quits his job and then seeks for a different job, sometimes it takes some time to get a new job. And lastly, the structural component is more of a long-term component, which is with regards to the mismatch between the skills that employers ask for in a worker and the skills that workers actually have. So it's a mismatch between those two components. With regards to Oken's coefficient, which is actually the coefficient indicating the impact of output on unemployment, has been studied in different countries, and most of the studies have indicated that indeed there is supposed to be a negative relationship between output growth and unemployment. However, the magnitude depends, of course, with regards to what kind of variables you use, so the control variables, the time period you use, which country we're talking about, and also the type of model that you use.
Okay, continuing with a specific case of Curaçao. Between 87 and... Between 87 and 2015, Curaçao's economy expanded by 1.1% on average. However, this growth figure generates a distorted picture of the economy of Curaçao because it includes a trend break in 1996 caused by the introduction of a new system of national accounts in that year. Removing the trend break in 1996 leads to a much lower GDP growth of 0.6 on average, broadly in line with the average GDP growth of 0.5 registered in more recent period of 2005 to 2015. In addition, during the entire period of 1987 and 2015, Curaçao's unemployment rate averaged 14.9%. However, in the shorter period of 2005 up to 2015, the unemployment rate was lower, namely 12.1% on average. This means that Curaçao's unemployment rate has declined overall, a bit still higher than the Caribbean and world averages of 10.4 and 5.9 respectively. The figures above show on the slide show the development in the real GDP growth rate and unemployment rate in Curaçao over our sample period. It seems that Oken's relationship does not apply on the first glance for the entire period. Particularly in the last 2 years, the Curaçao economy has been stagnant, contracting in 2013 and 14, as my colleague mentioned, and growing only slightly in 2015. While the unemployment rate has been declining. This contradictory development raises the question of whether Oken's relationship is applicable for Curaçao economy in the short run and the long run or not. Continuing with our data and method, following two versions of Oken's law, growth or difference and gap models were constructed. In the gap models, the Hodrick-Prescott filter and cubic and quartic equations were applied to calculate potential output and natural unemployment in Curaçao. To this end, an autoregressive distributed lag approach to co-integration and an error correction model were applied to account for short-run and long-run dynamics. Okay, the figures depict the trend and cyclical output growth and unemployment in Curaçao using the HP filter and the QE and CE. After decomposing the unemployment and real GDP growth rates into their trend and cyclical components, co-integration and ECM techniques were applied to test for the short-run and long-run causal causal relationships between the variables. Okay, the first step of the modeling process was a bounce test was conducted for a null hypothesis of no co-integration between variables. The calculated Walt statistic was compared with the critical value. In this equation, beta and gamma represent the short-run dynamics of the model, whereas lambda 1 and 2 stand for a long-run relationship. In the second step, the ARDL model was estimated with the optimal lag length chosen according to Icaic information criterion. This restricted version of the above equation was then solved for the long run. Okay, and thirdly, if there seems to be a long run relationship, we estimated the ECM, which provides the speed of adjustment back to a long run equilibrium after a short run shock. Okay, I give my word to my colleague for the following section.
With regards to empirical results, I will not go much into detail with regards to the results, but only the highlights. So if we take a look at a long-run relationship, we can see that similar to other studies that have been discussed or have been analyzed, the estimation shows you, so the second column shows you that it is approximately around minus 2 point something. So that is basically the Oken's coefficient in this case. And previous studies have indicated that it's around minus 2 to -3, at least most of them. Another interesting indication is the fourth column, so where you see the adjusted R squared, which basically shows the explanatory power of the model. In this case, more than 50% of the model is being explained for our case, which is kind of significant, or at least gives a good indication of it. However, what is interesting when we take a look at the short-run relationship is that the adjusted R squared becomes very low, indicating a low explanatory power and therefore implying a weak short-run relationship, basically implying that output growth does not necessarily indicate employment gains right away. What is even more interesting is that if we take a look at equation 1C, which basically is the relationship between total unemployment and total output, compare it with the other two, which are the gap models, which basically is the output gap versus the unemployment gap, or better said, the cyclical components of both. If we take away the cyclical component of output and we include the total output, so we compare total output growth with the cyclical component of unemployment, then the results remain the same, which basically indicates that what I've previously mentioned, output growth does not necessarily in the short run translate into employment gains. Or better said, with regards to the last few years in the case of Curacao, the stagnant economy did not automatically translate into an increase in the unemployment rate. Because, as I indicated, in those models, we use a cyclical component. And what I discussed in the literature review is that we can divide the unemployment in three components, right? The frictional one, the cyclical one, and the structural one, indicating that if the cyclical component has a low explanatory power, this means that probably in those 2 years, the decline in the unemployment rate was caused by either frictional or structural unemployment, so not the cyclical component. That explains why that that relationship does not have a high adjusted R squared. Finally, what is interesting to note also is that the goodness of fit of the models, all models pass those diagnostic tests. So not only the ones that are the standard for OLS regressions, so zero autocorrelation, homoscedasticity, normally distributed errors, and linear model specification, but also the stability of the models, which gives a good indication that indeed we can use the model. Of course, with statistics, you can never say this is it, but at least you can give an indication and have an idea of what we can do or what the relationship and if Oken's law applies or not.
Let's have a So does Oakland's law apply for the to the Curaçao economy? Well, yes, there seems to be a significant relationship. The Oakland coefficients are depending on the model we've chosen for the long run, seems to be 0.3% and 2.3% minus 3.3% and minus 2.9%, and for the short run, it's a weak relationship, which is 1.9% and 3.5%. However, like my colleague just mentioned, output growth does not automatically lead to employment gains in the short run. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Once more, thank you very much. We realized, excellent results in the long run and poor results, I would say, in the short run. But at least all models seem to have good Durbin-Watson statistics. And I was particularly heartened to see that they have good Harkebera statistics as well. Let me abuse the chair before I open up and ask a question of my own. When the presentation started, you said you corrected for the break in the series, which has to do with the move from SNA 68 to 93. That means you would keep having to remove this kind of break because soon you will move on to SNA 2008. Haven't you considered using dummy variables in the model to deal with this type of breaks in series? The floor is open. Yes, please.
Hi, yes. Could you go back to your slides where you looked at the coefficients? I just wanted to mention something. The slide where you looked at the coefficients. Go back. Back some more. Right. Well, the next one. Right. You talked about relatively low explanatory power. But those T statistics, the asterisks next to them indicate significance, right? So it looks as though, well, one asterisk means significant at the 90%, etc. So they are significant. So these results are not necessarily poor. They indicate what to you, what to me is the most interesting part about this whole paper, the fact that in the short run, it's not the cyclical unemployment that has any kind of impact. It's the structural and frictional. So my question is, how was that borne out in your observation? Has there been, what kind of unemployment have you observed? Because this is a nice start, but then you want to be able to say, well, the proof of that is that during this time, you had a lot of people looking for jobs, you had a lot of people who's with a mismatch and so on. Have you noticed anything in your observation to back up what this model is saying? Thanks.
Yes, Abdullah.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. A very interesting presentation. I don't think I've ever listened to an economist present to make economics so interesting. I now know why you are so interested in being a teacher. My question is very simple, and it has to do with the period of your sample size, and which will have implication for the robustness of your result. I was actually hoping that you say Oakland's law doesn't hold for Curaçao because of the preliminary data that you showed, the trend. So have you tried, what time period did you use for your estimation? And did you try breaking this into different time periods to see if that will, or shifting, you know, the sample size to see if that's going to affect your estimation? Bearing in mind that you are estimating a long-run relationship, which will also have implication for your for the sample size that you're using. Thanks.
Thank you, Chair. Excellent presentation.
Lefern?
Yes, please. Yeah, thank you.
excellent presentation. I was just wondering that the paper appears to start off on the premise of accepting Okun's law. I wanted to know if you did a causation, because Okun's law basically assumes causation in one way. Did you do a test for causation in the other direction? And what does it say about the transition of Curaçao's economy, especially in a context where we are in an age of technology, where you do less to get more, and the implication of that in terms of unemployment and output? Thank you.
Please, could you answer?
Okay, thank you for your questions, first of all. With regards to your question for the dummy variables, what we actually did in this research is that we excluded that observation of the 1996 due to the trend break, but indeed the dummy variable is a possibility for maybe I could test it and then see what the differences are with regards to the impact. But when you actually include the observation, like if you take everything without including a dummy variable, it does have a huge impact because it makes the relationship very weak with regards to long-term and short-term. So that is the reason also why by taking that problem away, then you get a better view, because the jump due to that trend break is very huge with regards to the output growth. Is that, with regards to the frictional and structural question, so if we are actually taking a deeper look at the impact of the results, yes, in a certain way. Why? Because by indicating that the cyclical component probably doesn't have such a huge impact as you would expect, because indeed you can see that the t-statistics is significant, meaning that it does give a good relationship. However, the explanatory power is low. This means then we have to take a look at what the impact could be, or better said, if it is the frictional or if it is structural component. Actually, currently at the Central Bank, we're doing a research with regards to measuring labor productivity. And in measuring that labor productivity, you can see per sector what the developments are. And what you can see is that what is interesting then is that my personal opinion, of course, it's work in progress, so I can't say yes, it's frictional or yes, it's structural. However, I do like to point out that my personal opinion is that it's more frictional. Why? Because certain sectors like hotels and restaurants and also construction sectors, those kind of sectors are closely related to frictional, so to seasonal developments. So for example, in a certain period where you have a lot of tourists, like high season, then you get a lot more of workers than during other periods which are low seasons. So my personal opinion that is that it goes more into the frictional component. However, I also want to indicate that with regards to structural unemployment, there are some efforts that are already being done, publicly based and also privately based, to help that part. So to try to match the youth unemployment with regards to work. So not only the Ministry of Labor, SOAWE, Ministry of Social Affairs and Labor, but also I'm actually in an action program, a Tiger Team, to help that youth development. And what you get is that you get a lot of information with regards to that matching process. So with regards to a lot of the youth problems. Why? Because youth unemployment is the highest of the total unemployment. So that's why it's important to get more insight into which are the areas where you need to tackle. So which are the workers or young workers that need a job, and where can you actually place them? So with regards to sum it up, because I talked a lot, to sum it up, with regards to structural unemployment, there are efforts currently going on to continue helping that. And with regards to frictional, is my personal opinion that it's more related to these findings, as in seasonal developments. Okay. Then for the third question with regards to the time period, we chose, if we take a look at, Okay, so as you can see here, the annual time series period used is 1987 to 2015. However, I do agree that you should take a look at a more recent period or the longer period. We did take a look also at the shorter time period. I don't remember on which year we started off, but I do remember that something, I think it was 2005 to 2015, something like that. I cannot recall because it has been a some time ago. But the actual results do remain the same. So not as in the same, but it remains roughly the same. So you can still conclude that even if you take the shorter sample, that these results remain intact. So basically the lower explanatory power for the short run period and the better explanatory power for the long run period. And with regards to the last question, so the other direction, taking into account the technology, I do agree that technology is a very important component, especially lately now that, because I mean, in 1987, we didn't have that much technology. Well, I can't speak because I'm from 1990, but anyway, you get the point. So we didn't have the technologies that we have now. So that also has an impact on how we produce, what we actually, why are we unemployed or why we are employed. And that is also related to the paper I previously mentioned with regards to measuring labor productivity, because what you can see is that sectors that are more focused on technology-based produce more than other sectors that are less technology-based and more manually based. So that is maybe interesting to later on when that paper is finished to maybe send it to you guys or share it or something that you can take a look and also see what the impact is of technology. Did I answer all the questions, or does anyone have any further remarks or questions?
Okay. Thank you. That was a passionate answering of the questions, and I would say quite skillful answering of the questions. One issue remains: we have to be careful as statisticians, the issue of simply dropping the odd year. I still feel that it should have been dealt with using dummy variables. We can easily be accused of, you know, picking our periods to obtain whatever result we want, and we don't want that. The fact of the matter is you need a longer series. That is also going back to look at the question about period. If you use a distributed lag model, you need a long time series. Otherwise, you will run into difficulties in estimating the model. Okay, yes.
I agree with you, and maybe it's possible to include maybe a short note or something in the paper that where we also indicate what the changes are when you include the dummy variable with regards to that year. It's always a possibility.
Okay. Thank you very much. And you see, Amir and Shekina even raised the bar higher now. You see, excellent presentation and sticking with their time. You see, I didn't have to show them. I like to show this to people, you know, and put them under pressure. And especially the 1 minute side, not the 5 minute side, but the 1 minute side, you see people get all sweaty, you know. It was not necessary. We're now on to a short 10-minute break, and then we'll resume.